Okay, this is my video manager, and I'm looking at the videos that I've been posting, and I noticed why I didn't get a lot of hits sometimes, the best videos, and I get these little checks that says video is blocked in some countries. Let's see what's going on there. Your video may include that it is owned and administered. Oh yeah. Let's read more.
Solar flares may seem like faraway events, but they can damage satellites and even ground-based technologies and power grids. Every 11 years, as the sun reaches its maximum activity, they become bigger and more common, and that increases the chances that one will significantly affect Earth. So what are these solar eruptions? A solar flare is basically an explosion on the surface of the sun, ranging from minutes to hours in length. Large flares can release enough energy to power the entire United States for a million years. Flares happen when the powerful magnetic fields in and around the sun reconnect. They're usually associated with active regions, often seen as sunspots, where the magnetic fields are strongest. Flares are classified according to their strength. The smallest ones are B class, followed by C, M, and X, the largest. Similar to the Richter scale for earthquakes, each letter represents a tenfold increase in energy output. So an X is 10 times an M and 100 times a C. Within each letter class, there is a finer scale from 1 to 9. C-class flares are too weak to noticeably affect Earth. M-class flares can cause brief radio blackouts at the poles and minor radiation storms that might endanger astronauts. It's the X-class flares that are the real juggernauts. Although X is the last letter, there are flares more than 10 times the power of an X1, so X-class flares can go higher than 9. The most powerful flare on record was in 2003, during the last solar maximum. It was so powerful that it overloaded the sensors measuring it. They cut out an X17, and the flare was later estimated to be about X45. A powerful X-class flare like that can create long-lasting radiation storms, which can harm satellites, and even give airline passengers flying near the poles small radiation doses. X-flares also have the potential to create global transmission problems and worldwide blackouts. The seriousness of an X-class flare pointed at Earth is why NASA and NOAA constantly monitor the sun. NASA's heliophysics fleet of spacecraft can now see the sun from every side and in many different wavelengths. This unprecedented coverage is enabling scientists to predict and detect space weather events like flares and CMEs with ever greater accuracy. With advance warning, governments and companies can take steps to protect their technological infrastructure so that the worst scenarios will never happen.
Thank you. Thank you.
Okay, you gotta explain what you just said in Creole.
How are you over there? That's what I said.
Okay, now say it in Creole again.
Como você está para lá?
Anything else you want to know about Creole, speak it now, and you'll have it on the video. What would you like to say to the Cape Verdean people over there on the island?
I hope that soon we'll be over to visit you guys. We're going to go follow our roots. That's where our family came from.
Now say that in Creole.
You just started with it one day?
Soon we'll be over
to. Un dia nossa barca vem, pode comer os estepala, pode comer nossa família nascido para lá. Eu creio que a coxa é um dono, cunhador, que está nascido. Um dia nossa barca para lá, para nem mim nem ele que a barca vem.
Não, see, she said all that.
But I said, I don't know.
But say, we just.
As we found the same writing on stones in certain countries like Ecuador, Colombia, Illinois, United States, Lozère, France, Malta in the Mediterranean, Turkmenistan, Australia, and in southern Calabria, Italy, just a few years ago, always there are stones. This, we think, is a medical instrument. It is also lyddite, and it's a perfect form. Another one, and these are other ones. They are very much smaller than shown on this photo. And when we did material check in Vienna, the most expert worldwide checked those pieces. First of all, the material, each one is done with lyddite, and the form itself, we checked them, and finally he said, I cannot tell you how they were done, who did they make, but the only thing I can definitely tell you, from the same material in our days, we cannot make the same instruments. So, how old they are we do not know, but they were found in Colombia and they do not fit any existing pre-Columbian culture. We must consider that those artifacts are at least older than 6,000 years. But we cannot explain what kind of technology they did use to be able to make such instruments and such tools made with lyddite. You can see each piece fits exactly every kind of hand, never mind how big the size of the hand was. Each instrument, each tool fits exactly each hand which was using those instruments. This face looks a little bit like the Maui, the big stone statues from Easter Island. Here you have a close-up. This, in joking, I call it the dentist chair. Perfectly done, but again, same material, lyddite. And the strange question is, why, if they could make such perfect figurines out of this very difficult material, why did they show the human face always with big round eyes and a little nose and a big mouth? There is no real explanation possible. This is again one piece from Colombia. Luddite. On the front side, you see the mother holding the baby, and on the back side, you see the man with armors, most probably for hunting. This stone figurine was found in Colombia. It looks exactly like the Maui statues from Easter Island, but it is only about 30 centimeters in size. This is another masterpiece of stonework. You have on both sides presented one bird, but if you look at the front side, you can see that the two birds presenting a face, and on the left side between the bird's head and the wings, you see again this unknown writing which we found on stones from all over the world. This is the mother holding a child, very strange face, and it's a kind of jade material. This is another stone from Colombia showing an armadillo. On top of the armadillo you can see a strange face with long ear and two horns on top. On this artifact you can see a smiling face on top. You have two triangles on this side, and on the other side, on the right side, you have a face. Again, the animal face on the right side and some unknown symbols. And on the bottom of this object, you see an animal, looks like a crocodile. Now we are moving to Guinea, West Africa, very close to the border with Mali. They found on a huge granite mountain, but then again we are at the point 10 to 12,000 years ago, it might be the civilization, the lost civilization from Atlantis. Close to this area in Sierra Leone, Professor Pitoni was in charge of diamond excavations, and as he heard in this area a legend about Allah was angry with some angels and he put them into stone and threw them to the earth, he put the sky also made it into stone and threw it to the earth, and he put the stars and threw them to the earth. The legend says,
but I think this is very, very important to understand why we and everyone should be discussing these things. Three times in the New Testament, Matthew 12:31, Mark 3:28, Luke 12:10, we find Jesus telling his disciples the exact same message. In Matthew, he says, "Therefore I tell you, every sin and blasphemy will be forgiven men, but the blasphemy against the Spirit will not be forgiven. And whoever says a word against the Son of Man, generally accepted to mean Jesus, will be forgiven. But whoever speaks against the Holy Spirit will not be forgiven, either in this age or in the age to come." In Mark, we read, "I solemnly declare that any sin of man can be forgiven, even blasphemy against me. But blasphemy against the Holy Spirit can never be forgiven. It is an eternal sin." And in Luke, we read, "Yet those who speak against me may be forgiven, while those who speak against the Holy Spirit shall never be forgiven." Whoa, holy cow. So in other words, you can not believe in Jesus. You can blaspheme against Jesus. That's okay. That can be forgiven. But you cannot block the Holy Spirit. Well, what's the Holy Spirit? I've always had a problem with that. Even back in Baptist Bible school, you know, they talk about the Holy Ghost.
Yeah, well, when I was a kid.
What are we talking about here? Well,
we used to talk about the Holy Ghost, and I was always kind of very iffy about the Holy Ghost. I mean, it was
exactly
scary or
funny. Forget the ghost. It's the Holy Spirit. And just like we have school spirit and national spirit, we have the Spirit of God, the Holy Spirit. And what is that? John gives us the answer. He says, "I will send you the Comfort, the Holy Spirit, the source of all truth." The Spirit of God is the Spirit of truth. You have to go for the Spirit of truth. We have to learn who we truly are, where we truly came from. And yet, look at most religions today. Oh, don't study any other religion. Don't listen to anybody else. Here's the dogma. Accept this. Have faith. Just believe in this. They are blocking the Holy Spirit. They are committing the unforgivable sin of stopping the search for the truth. You, me, William, everybody listening to this program, we're opening our minds. We're trying to find out what's true. We're trying to find out what's really going on. We are working in the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of God's truth. Now, I say, hey, sound like a Baptist preacher, but, man, there it is. It's, to me, it's just so clear. You know, you question everything, but
we
don't stand in the way of
the Holy
truth.
Spirit, the ones they call evil and say we're pagans and blasphemers and everything,
and
yet I might add, just in the most popular Christian thing that appeared in recent years was The Passion of the Christ. And I watched that film, as difficult an experience as it was for someone who really has a genuine love of Christ, and I never saw in it the words, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." They left that out. And therefore, The Passion of the Christ was a monstrous blasphemy. Because that is the message from the cross. That is the message that raises the human spirit. It is next to the message of the resurrection itself. It is the single most important message that Christ left for us. And they left it out. Because without it, you can come into contact with all of the darkness, the hate, the prejudice that lies down in the depths of your own soul. And so I thought to myself, the demon has done this, and the demon rules the millions. This radio program, this will be heard probably about 2,000 or 3,000 people in the subscriber section of Unknown Country. Download it and give it to friends. It comes out to about 15,000 people. How many people will listen to the message of the resurrection of the Christ? 90 million people. Now, does that mean that this winnowing is actually taking place before our eyes? That people are being identified as to who seeks the truth and who seeks the death of the soul?
I think that pretty well sums up the battle of good versus evil that's taking place right now. It's not people with turbans on their head versus
sandy-haired wasp. It's not Muslims versus Christians. It's none of that. People all over the world who seek the truth, who value the truth, who work for the truth, who try to live in the truth, they are the ones that are living as the words that Jesus spoke. The ones who try to put a cap on the truth and say, well, don't listen to any of that, and don't listen to that enemy propaganda, and don't listen to that other religion, those are the people who are committing the unpardonable sin of blocking the spirit of truth, which is the spirit of God, which is also called the Holy Spirit.
William, what is the Holy Spirit?
Well, in the Bible, it's referred to as manna. It's referred to as dew. It's referred to as a heavenly substance. And, you know, I make it a practice when I'm doing presentations, Willie, and very often I'll have people that have a very strong Christian background, many, many years of Sunday school, and they're not authorities on the religion, but they've certainly been in it for half of their adult lives. And I'll ask them a very simple question. How did Jesus transmit the Holy Spirit to the disciples? And I will tell you, Whitley, if there's a 50 people in the audience, maybe one or two will know of the Christians that are there. He breathed on them. And the question that is never asked and certainly never taught in Christian circles is, what did he breathe on them? And it's when we go back into the ancient world and we look at, for example, the mystic pharaoh Akhenaten, who breathed upon his daughter and breathed into her eyes and breathed into her nostrils the breath of life. We're talking about a very ancient science of whereby the individual learns to attune themselves with the highest vibrations coming from the source, which we are suggesting here could be the center of our Milky Way galaxy. But the Holy Spirit is a transmittable substance that one has to learn to attune themselves with. And when that happens, they become what the Gnostic Christians in the 13th and 14th century called illumined ones. And this was a title that was ascribed in particular to Mary Magdalene. She was given the gift of the Holy Spirit, and as a consequence, she was given the title the illumined one, the illuminator. And the text describe her as literally giving off the glow ray of God. Now, you have preachers all the time on TV talking about the glow ray of God. You're in God's glow ray. But they have no idea whatsoever what the glory of God refers to, that it in fact is evidence that a person has attuned themselves with these higher energies, perhaps even these very radio waves that we've been talking about on Dreamlander and now discussing once again. That once we are attuned with those glow rays, we literally emit light from within ourselves.
And that's why that years ago when the New Age movement kind of got started, and I kept hearing people talk to me about the higher frequencies, okay? And this whole thing came up about frequencies, and I couldn't understand it at that time, and I'm not claiming to totally understand it now, but we're talking about the vibrational rate of the energy of the universe. And so I think this is exactly what we're talking about. And what we're saying here is, like, William has, you talked about how we're coming together here, and I guess we are, but I assure you I have not worked with William, and William has not worked with me. And I've kind of approached this from a 50s, 60s science foundation, and William has approached it from the a study of ancient records and of ancient theologies and all like that, and yet they seem to be dovetailing quite nicely right now in my mind. What about you, William?
Oh, I totally agree, Jim. And, you know, as you mentioned earlier, you know, what this time appears to be all about right now is capturing an essence, a vibration that comes from the heavens that was referred to in ancient times as manna, dew, the Holy Spirit. And once this vibration, the Holy Spirit, comes upon the planet, it uplifts all who understand how to embody it. And when you've got a religious and political authority on the planet that is seeking to withhold that knowledge from you, you have to ask, why are they doing it? As Jim mentioned, it's power and control. But I don't know, I just am getting the sense that this is going to be just an awesome wave of energy that's about to pour over the planet, and it's going to cause a major blossoming, I feel, of millions of people, some possibly spontaneously, but there's going to be many, many others that are right now on this path of learning how to make or to operate this flower of life that our soul inhabits that we call the human body.
William, you mentioned something in Dreamland about the pineal gland and what we need to do with or to the pineal gland. Could you elaborate on that?
Certainly. When you look at numerous examples of ancient art, they will show a goddess, for example, Mari, who's standing in front of a tower that is topped by a pine cone-shaped object. It looks like a rocket on a silo. But what it really is it's our pineal gland sitting right dead center in our brain. And what we're beginning to learn and understand, like as did the alchemists and some of the mystics of the past, that pineal gland can be stimulated by various substances. And when it is stimulated, it becomes what is called the philosopher's stone. And primarily what the philosopher's stone is the pineal gland's ability to remove the interval of time in between a thought and an action. That is the philosopher's stone. So that ultimately what it means is that you think a thought and the actions are the same. Presently, I think the thought of picking up the cell phone that's on the table in front of me, and it takes a moment for me to reach out and pick it up. As these energies begin to pour on the planet and our pineal glands are encrusted, as I call it, or decalcified, as science calls it, when the crust comes off the pineal gland, it's blown wide open and is capable of operating at this higher level.
Well, and that may explain why the Illuminati, the power control bunch, the New World Order, has gained total control over the large pharmaceutical corporations, and instead of giving us natural substances that would allow our natural abilities to blossom forth, we are more and more and more becoming addicted to all kinds of petrochemical-based drugs that I think are designed to keep us in a low vibrational state and keep us, barefoot and ignorant, you know. And I think that's exactly what's going on. Now, the only part I would disagree with William on is he talks about this energy flow that's about to come and it's about to get on, and I think it's already happening. It's happening right now, and this is why we're seeing tremendous earth changes taking place. Just in the last 10 years or so, we have seen some of the worst hurricanes, the worst tornadoes, we have droughts, we have all kinds of geophysical changes that are taking place on this planet because the planet is responding to this new vibrational rate, and it's up to us to try to get in step and try to get up to that level too so that we can cope with all of this.
You know, goddammit, you know, what angers the hell out of me is the damn punctified preachers and leaders who know the truth but won't speak it for fear that something bad is going to happen to them. If you know the truth, speak it. And if you're gonna die, damn it, die on the truth that you are man enough to speak.
A little-known occult group may have been an inspiration for one of the most terrifying ideologies of the 20th century. It formed a dark fellowship that was established nearly 100 years ago. It seems that its original members believed that they could live below the Earth's surface and fly to distant stars. Their power would be a mysterious substance called Vril. They also believed that one day they would take over the world. They came very close. The mysterious group claimed influence in the highest ranks of the German power structure of the 1930s. This dark fellowship may have been a Nazi cult. The stories of history's dark fellowships strike fear into many hearts. But what are the truths behind the stories? Throughout history, there have been secret organizations striving for influence in political circles. But if the bizarre legends about the Vril Society are true, the organization is particularly unsettling.
The Vril Society is the most mysterious German secret society ever in history. They were originally founded before the Second World War, and their influence reaches out even till today.
Its members are said to have included senior figures in the Nazi Party, like Hermann Göring, Heinrich Himmler, and even Adolf Hitler.
The Vril Society was a dark fellowship. They sought to achieve the mastery of the Aryan race.
Before they were able to influence the Nazis, Vril occultists worked in complete secrecy, doing anything to promote Aryan power.
What they did, that ranged from straightforward political assassinations, trying to evoke the spirits of the dead, good old-fashioned, what one might call, sexual orgies, and, more sinisterly, human sacrifice.
Michael Fitzgerald is one of just a few historians willing to identify the secrets of the Vril Society. Few records exist, but he claims first-hand sources.
Some of my information about the Vril Society has come from direct sources. Some of them swore me to secrecy during their lifetime and have now died.
So he is now free to offer his assessment.
The Vril Society was a group of people founded at the end of the First World War, and it included many people who were to go on to become prominent in the Nazi Party.
Like any secret society, it had its secret practices. But what made the Vril Society so unique was its members' obsession with an intangible power force called Vril.
This power was universal energy. It could do anything. All currents of harm and healing and so on were enclosed within it. It's similar to the Indian concept of prana in many ways, or the Chinese concept of qi.
Chinese philosophers believe that qi is the life energy that runs through us all. The Vril Society believed they could harness this energy.
And they believed that Vril power could be used to gain material power.
So they were frantically searching for this Vril force.
Dutchman Theo Pijmans has dedicated 25 years of his life to studying the Vril Society.
My research has established that certain bureaus in Nazi Germany were frantically searching for this new energy.
Obtaining supernatural power might require supernatural efforts.
They sought the power of Vril through a variety of different means. They were naturally meditative practices, which were obviously the mainstay of most of their activities.
But they weren't meditating to gain inner peace.
The theory is that they practiced these meditation techniques in order to further the strength of the Vril in themselves.
If it was a strength that could potentially dominate the world, wouldn't the members of the Vril Society have done more than esoteric meditation to attain it?
They were also very involved with what might I call loosely sex magic.
There's an enormous history of sexual magic going back to witches and witches using sexual powers. This is nothing new.
Members of the society are said to have used the magic of sex to summon the power of Vril.
There were some sexual practices that went on in the Vril Society.
This carnal method of harvesting Vril was less magical and closer to an excuse for swapping partners.
They were swingers.
Group sex and meditation couldn't really be considered evil and were not exactly unique in the early 20th century. But the Vril Society may have had more sinister rituals.
The darkest side of the Vril was undoubtedly their belief, which dates back many thousands of years, that to sacrifice a young child will give more power than anything else if you are turning to the darkness. and that is what they did.
After the First World War, many illegitimate and orphan children lived in Bavaria. Children whose disappearance would go unnoticed. And legend had it that the vril of a child was the most concentrated and most powerful.
They were seen as being gateways between the astral and the material world in a way that adults were not. So consequently, they were ideal victims for human sacrifice.
Human sacrifices to harness an intangible energy. Where did this vril notion come from? The bizarre concept had been hijacked and distorted from a science fiction novel. After the First World War, a bizarre cult called the Vril Society flourished in Germany. It took its name from a supernatural force, Vril, that could bestow immense power on anyone who could harness it. The concept of Vril was expounded in a book published in 1871 called The Coming Race, written by Edward Bulwer-Lytton.
In that book, he describes an underground race called the Vrilia.
And they have complete mastery of the Vril force.
And with that, they can do almost anything.
It was pure science fiction, but it captured an audience and made them firm believers in Vril.
And he falls through a crack and finds himself in a subterranean world inhabited by a race of super beings called the Vril-Ya, who live down there and who have access to this magical energy, this strange electrofluid called Vril.
Vril?
Vril.
Vril.
Vril. Gives them the power to do almost anything. They can use it to heal, they can use it to kill.
They can also destroy mankind in the blink of an eye.
And anyone who harnessed this power could wield it.
The protagonist finds out in the course of the novel that a child could use Vril to destroy an entire city.
So imagine if this Vril existed and got into the wrong hands. Could it be that some aspects of Nazi philosophy stem from ideas in a science fiction novel?
Lytton's novel, The Coming Race, in many respects precursored at least some of the ideology that led to The Final Solution.
This superior race, which is explicitly linked in the book with the Aryan races, can manifest and can control. And that just struck a chord in Europe particularly.
And following the devastation suffered from World War I, some Germans desperately wanted to associate themselves with such a superior race.
Perhaps nobody could believe that this science fiction was fiction.
At the end of the book comes with a very serious warning.
These subterranean keepers of the Vril could destroy mankind.
Should they come up and decide they wanted to colonize the surface of the planet, we would be doomed.
It may seem a kind of tabloid truth that one would expect to find in sensational newspapers, but the Vril Society really were consciously dedicated to the service of evil. And by their impact on the founders of the Nazi Party, they instilled that evil into the senior leadership of what was to become the most evil regime in the 20th century.
Most sources say that the Vril Society was founded in 1918 at a mysterious meeting in the Bavarian town of Berchtesgaden. It was a holiday center and would later house the country retreat of Adolf Hitler. It is said that in a mountain lodge, a group of occultists and high-ranking German nationalists secretly gathered to create a powerful inner circle called the All-German Society for Metaphysics, otherwise known as the Vril Society.
Essentially, it was founded by two people, Rudolf von Sebottendorf.
Von Sebottendorf had been very active in the occult movement. He was a Freemason, an alchemist, and a founder of the Thule Society. Their belief in a mythical civilization was a precursor to Nazi Aryan ideas.
His real name was Adam Glauer, and he was the son of an engine driver, but he gave himself, awarded himself a title of nobility.
In creating the Vril Society, von Sebottendorf was joined by a man who would darkly influence world history.
The other main person within it was Dietrich Eckart.
He was said to have strong powers of persuasion, particularly in his anti-Semitic writings.
Dietrich Eckart was Hitler's closest personal friend between 1918 and his death in 1923.
Eckart believed he was paving the road for Germany's own savior.
He was, in many respects, a mad genius. And it's no accident he spent a great part of his time in and out of mental institutions.
The founder of the Vril went by a very curious name.
John the Baptist.
And we all know that in the Bible, John Baptist is a sort of a paver of the road for the true Messiah.
Eckart was also one of the masterminds behind the Nazi Party.
Eckart saw Hitler as the German Messiah. He saw him as the man sent to save the country.
And he wasn't the only Vril founder who felt that way. It has been suggested that these two men were joined by two women, mediums responsible for finding the hidden occult truths and harvesting Vril.
In those days, it was the golden age of what was known as physical mediumship, where not only were they forever moving objects and table turning and floating, levitating, but also they used to produce a substance called ectoplasm out of their bodies.
One of these mediums is said to have predicted the new German Messiah.
During her state of trance, she declared that the apparition she had given form to was going to be the next German Messiah, who she proceeded to name as Adolf Hitler.
So the Vril Society may have indeed paved the way for the person they would promote as the country's Messiah. Their next step would have been to secure his ultimate weapon, Vril.
They believed that that would give them power.
This occult group of German nationalists may have grown quickly to become an elite inner circle of the Nazi Party.
Many of the top leaders, including Hitler himself, were members of the Vril Society. Karl Harrer, Anton Drexler and Dietrich Eckart are three of the most important figures in the transition from the Vril Society to the Nazi Party.
Eckart was considered the darkest of them all and dedicated to Hitler's success.
He did have certain perverse gifts, and not least of which was his ability to train Hitler in the use of, you know, what one might loosely call the power of a human heart and human mind.
Hermann Göring, commander of the Luftwaffe, was said to be a member.
It is virtually certain that he was introduced to it in around 1920, probably by Dietrich Eckart.
Alfred Rosenberg, minister of the Third Reich, probably a member.
Rosenberg believed that the Aryan race was superior to every other, of course. And, you know, he believed that Jesus was not Jewish, but an Aryan.
Rudolf Hess, deputy Führer, another likely member.
Hess believed everything. He used to sleep with magnets under his bed to try and draw off harmful emanations.
Martin Bormann, chief of the Nazi Party Chancellery, also thought to be a member.
Martin Bormann was probably considered the most evil one. He was an avowed and open Satanist. He was quite categorical about his desire to exterminate Christianity as well as Judaism, because he saw Christianity as simply, as he called it, a Jewish perversion.
And the most senior Nazi in the Vril Society, Adolf Hitler himself.
Hitler was, by definition, a dark person, but he took advantage of the dark fellowship of the Vril Society for his own ends.
Hitler is said to have used the frenzy surrounding this occult group to his advantage, manipulating its members.
Not one of the members had an iota of his ruthlessness and, in a sense, intelligence.
Hitler used any means that he could, including the occult fanaticism of the era, as a tool to help his rise to the top.
He saw the whole thing consciously as a means to an end, which was the transformation of Germany and the establishment of himself as its leader.
But he did have some deep occult beliefs of his own.
He believed to a considerable extent that occult forces, or whatever one likes to call them, this Vrilbauer, had some kind of reality.
Some believe his first occult exposure happened just before World War I in Vienna, when he met a man named Lanz von Liebenfels.
Von Liebenfels thought Hitler was a natural medium.
Von Liebenfels was obsessed with the Aryan occult. He was known to frequent the ancient town of Carnuntum in Austria, where the Germans defeated the Romans in the first century.
He invented a whole new religion that he called Ariosophy.
And he made his bizarre beliefs known publicly.
He published a magazine called Ostara, which was full of racial ramblings and bizarre occult philosophy.
Hitler was allegedly an avid reader of Liebenfels' pamphlet.
He actually physically advocated that the Jews should be killed simply for being Jewish.
With this racist teaching, Hitler was one step closer to Vril and the final solution. But how is it possible that a dark fellowship as bizarre as the Vril Society could even exist, let alone contribute to the most evil regime in modern history?
It has had an influence on world history out of all proportion.
The confusion surrounding the era offers clues to the Vril Society's influence.
It was a very convoluted time. There were a multitude of secret societies.
From about 1888, well into the 1920s, hundreds of secret societies formed, reformed, and gave birth to new and even more secret subgroups. Some were dangerous nationalistic orders, like the Serbian Black Hand Society, responsible for the assassination of Archduke Franz Ferdinand of Austria.
Black Hand Society was largely responsible for the First World War.
And many of the era's dark fellowships were simply racist, sharing the sentiments of Lanz von Liebenfels, who believed Aryans were gods.
He also believed that the Jews were literally children of the devil.
The 30 years leading to the formation of the Vril Society was an era obsessed with the strange combination of racial solidarity and the occult.
Magic and occult ideas dominated thinking of virtually every class of society in the late 19th century.
But of all the mystics of the time, one person's writings may have been the genesis of the phenomenal occult frenzy. Madame Elaine Petrova Blavatsky.
I would say that Blavatsky provided the metaphysical framework that has gathered together the vast, vast streams of the ancient wisdom into a coherent system.
Blavatsky founded the Theosophical Society in 1875 and established herself as a kind of sage in the occult realm. Theosophists believe in a combination of Asian and occult ideas to promote the concept of a superior Aryan race.
She traveled throughout the world for spiritual reasons.
Madame Blavatsky wrote, well, several books, but a particularly influential one was The Secret Doctrine.
It was based on knowledge she acquired in India and Tibet.
She claimed that she got her teachings from secret messages from Mahatmas in the Himalayas.
This groundbreaking book, written in 1885, did something no other book had ever done. It combined science and religion. Some branches of late 19th century European philosophy drew inspiration from a combination of the occult and Eastern mysticism. One leading proponent of these concepts was Madame Petrova Blavatsky, who managed to combine the precepts of both religion and science.
Suddenly science, like with Darwin, had seemed to destroy the possibility of religion, and Blavatsky was showing, oh, you can still believe in evolution and yet be religious, because it works. This is how it works, you know.
Her writings included anti-Semitic notions that fueled later groups like the Vril Society.
The secret doctrine had an extreme racist view.
Some interpret her writings to say that Semitic people had not evolved as far as the Aryans. But she was actually writing of the ancient Aryans, whose Indo-Iranian name means noble. They had simply migrated further than other races, and so they were more evolved.
The misrepresentation of Aryan is we are the master race.
Blavatsky's ancient Aryans were not the same as Hitler's 20th century Aryan race.
The secret doctrine clearly had anti-Semitic and racist undertones.
This is the danger of letting out high-level truths because of the danger of misrepresentation.
The secret doctrine was written as a spiritual teaching and a kind of esoteric study of evolution, not an inspiration for the master race.
But the racial aspects were the ones that particularly obviously appealed to the Nazis.
The world has shown the ghastly effects of twisting what is sacred knowledge and perverting it to one's own personal ends.
When the Vril Society was founded, Blavatsky's teachings were more popular in Germany than anywhere else in the world.
Seriously, it was that influential on German thought. It really was.
Like the coming race, Blavatsky's book was misunderstood and its ideas were twisted to support the many other racist philosophies rampant in Europe. So by 1918, the time was ripe for the formation of the Vril Society and the search for ultimate power.
Vril?
Vril.
Vril.
The Vril Society saw this power as a kind of metaphysical petrol.
The Germans needed it because Germany, as we know, did not have fossil fuel reserves. They had a method of creating synthetic fuels, but they were in desperate need for other energies.
In addition to their occult methods for finding this energy, they began an actual quest for the all-important Vril. They followed in Blavatsky's footsteps to Tibet. Vril Society member Karl Haushofer organized expeditions to Tibet beginning in 1923. Their mission? Contacting the Aryan forefathers in the cities deep underneath the Himalayas. They would certainly be the guardians of the Vril. And by the third trip, they were measuring the skulls of the locals, convinced the Tibetans were the Aryan ancestors. Eventually, Hitler formed a Nazi organization to track the Aryan race.
They spent more money on that than the United States did on the development of the atomic bomb.
That would be $20 billion in today's terms.
For work that frankly produced no tangible result.
And so, in the end, the Germans left.
But whether they found Vril there or not, the Germans did bring back one very important thing from Tibetan culture, something Blavatsky had waxed poetic about in The Secret Doctrine.
Within its mystical precincts lies the master key which opens the door of every science, physical as well as spiritual.
How could Madame Blavatsky have known this mystical figure would become the symbol of hate?
A great many of the Vril Society members were conscious Satanists.
And these evil men were emblazoned with a symbol, the swastika. Its mystical resonance was of great interest to the Vril Society, and by 1920, it would virtually belong to the Nazis. Previously, though, the swastika had been a symbol of luck and good fortune in Asia.
A lot of persons these days forget that before it became an ominous symbol in Nazi Germany, the swastika was to be found everywhere.
It was originally meant as a symbol of good fortune. It took on a very tangible meaning, that of the letter G, and for Freemasons, the word geometry.
Well, not only did it stand for geometry and math and so on, but it stood for Nordic, the old Norse gods. It was a symbol of Thor.
There was a village in Canada called Swastika, and they had a female hockey team called the Swastikas, with the swastika embroidered on their skirts, and it makes very lovely photos.
By 1920, it was no longer a benign symbol. In adopting the swastika, the Nazis did make one significant alteration.
Hitler and his cohorts did a funny thing. They changed the direction of the swastika.
It no longer turned to the right.
His concept of the swastika was very influential.
Hitler's swastika turned in the opposite direction, to the left. And the left-hand path is synonymous with evil.
The left-hand path, which is something that clearly derives from Roman mythology and affects all mythologies, where the evil gods are centered on the left side and the good gods are centered on the right side.
This is Hitler's swastika in 1920. It quickly became embedded in Nazi culture, and a variation of it has become known as a sign of the Vril Society. It's found here in Wewelsburg Castle, the home of Heinrich Himmler, commander of the SS and a suspected member of the Vril Society.
He was frantically searching for various means of winning the war, and in the end, one can say it turned him insane, although in my opinion, the seeds of his insanity were already there.
Himmler, of course, was probably the most lunatic of any senior Nazi party member.
He was mystical, he was a dreamer.
He was a real junkie for every cult and wacky idea going.
And he was an architect of Nazi ideology.
There are fascinating photos, and this I have never understood, of Himmler with his 12-year-old daughter visiting a concentration camp, a death camp. Now, who on earth would take his 12-year-old daughter to a death camp?
Perhaps only a man obsessed with absolute power would do that. And such a man would be the perfect candidate to renovate a 16th century castle as a Vril centerpiece.
Within this castle, we find a richness of symbols, of signs, and of occult things of significance that point towards his, well, the fulfillment of his dreams.
The North Tower holds the darkest symbols.
The North Tower clearly is the embodiment of all that Himmler felt was dear and precious to him, and it points towards an occult significance in his philosophies.
A feature of the tower was the solar wheel, or black sun, the occult symbol for the Vril Society.
Clearly, this sun wheel meant a great deal to Heinrich Himmler. What the solar wheel exactly was, who can tell?
It was, however, likely to impress members of the SS visiting the castle.
The SS was seen by Himmler as being part of a mystical order.
Himmler wanted an imposing headquarters for his SS cohorts. He performed weddings and funerals for them here.
It's alleged that even the full black mass was said to have been performed at Wewelsburg on two or three occasions.
But if that ultimate satanic ritual was celebrated at Wewelsburg, it would have been undertaken in another part of the tower, the crypt. In this bizarre room with its excellent acoustics, Himmler created a frightening arena for his elite SS men. There were pedestals around the sides, placed possibly for attending rituals and Vril Society meetings, and a peculiar space in the center, probably for Himmler himself.
But this is funny in the sense that if this is the center where the acoustics work the best and the most, then what was this, the purpose of the center meant for? Would that have been the place where Heinrich Himmler told about his wildest dreams?
Was this nightmarish place the focus of all things Vril? Did Himmler have it constructed to be the place where the most despicable rituals could take place?
This, of course, is one of these things that one will never know for certain.
Was it here that Himmler held his notorious Vril experiments?
This quack doctor called Rascher, who used to literally freeze prisoners until they were on the point of death, and then he would put naked prostitutes against their bodies to see if that would revive them, and then if so, they were then instructed to have sex with them, and then all the temperatures would be taken. Himmler called it animal magnetism, but it was essentially Vril-based.
Himmler may have been searching for Vril through sexuality.
Of course, it was ridiculous because 50% of the male subjects used to die. The experiments were undoubtedly inspired by Himmler's subscription to the notion of Vril.
Were these experiments held here in Himmler's center or elsewhere within the castle walls? Unfortunately, there are no written records or living eyewitnesses to reveal with certainty exactly what occurred within the walls of Himmler's Wiffelsburg. The Vril Society was unique among the secret societies of the era. One reason was that it included women as members.
Every woman in the Reich stands ready as any man to fight and die in the service of the fatherland. And, you know, this is true. There were probably more women than there were men in many respects.
Which is very important to realize because a lot of the Masonic groups were male only and a lot of the esoteric groups were male only.
But not the Vril Society. After all, the females in the coming race were superior to the males.
Women were seen, really, in a way, as being like almost divine.
Women would have been welcomed because their feminine energy was required to properly attain Vril. But Hitler's personal view was far more practical.
He actually felt that women were actually the soul of the nation and that they were going to carry on the legacy of National Socialism.
It is believed that two women became senior leaders of the Vril Society.
Countess von Reventlof was possibly the most well-known one.
And it's possible that her prominence led to her death. She suffered a mysterious and fatal bicycle accident in 1918, shortly after the Vril Society's inauguration.
She got executed.
Countess von Reventlof's assassins were members of the German Communist Party, people strongly opposed to the National Socialists.
Ludendorff's wife, who was the only other one that was of comparable importance, she broke with the Vril Society at a fairly early stage.
That may have been when her husband, Erich Ludendorff, became disillusioned with politics and left the Vril Society and the Nazi Party in 1923. Most of the women in the Vril Society served two primary purposes.
Sex was seen as a national duty.
Following World War I, one primary purpose of women in Germany was to replace the lost soldiers by having many German babies.
There was actually a huge drive towards birth to increase productivity.
And the prospect of making babies took on an element of fun at the time.
Anything that could be an escape or fun would be good.
The Vril Society may have taken fun a step further into sex for occult power.
To combine power with pleasure, it was kind of like nationalization of the sexual instinct.
And in a dark fellowship, sexual instinct might invite sexual magic.
Women in the Vril Society were often mediums.
In an era obsessed with the occult, there were many practicing mediums. And mediums were typically women. With secret societies dabbling in the occult rampant throughout Germany in the 1930s, successful mediums were in great demand. And the Vril Society held such women in high esteem.
They were considered to be particularly receptive channels between the ordinary world and the astral world.
Well, it sounds like a fascinating and novel concept, but clearly it is not. I mean, in Germany we had female mediums doing exactly that.
They didn't have any political influence in any way, and that what they essentially did was try and channel in the real power and then translate it out into the rest of the people in the room. A kind of psychic photosynthesis, one might say.
One bizarre legend suggests that the female founders of the group were receiving messages about Vril from other galaxies.
Well, it's been alleged that that the Vril Society was able to contact beings from Aldebaran and so on. That depends to a certain extent on your point of view.
It's not strange that these ideas would evolve or mutate into ideas of long-haired women communicating with people underneath the Earth and on other planets. Why not? It makes a better story. It's more fun.
The idea of two long-haired mediums communicating with other galaxies through automatic writing was not so outrageous in 1918.
There is this fascinating book that I held in my hand just yesterday. It was published in 1823, and it's called Voyages to the Sun, the Moon, and Other Planets. And it was written by a female medium at that time, 1823. So clearly the idea that two female mediums are involved in communicating with an interstellar civilization on Aldebaran in 1917 is not new.
And long hair also had a long tradition.
The long hair of the women is partly a throwback, of course, to the old days of the Valkyries, maidens and so on.
I wonder how much of this is borrowing themes from Wagner.
Naturally, not all women of the Vril Society were long-haired beauties. But all of the Vril Society legends, like everything surrounding the organization, were larger than life. Exaggeration was part of the plan, and that exaggeration included Heinrich Himmler's nightmarish castle.
This all could have been a stage prop, a setting, a fitting setting for Himmler's plans and Himmler's evil dreams. It's a very clever ploy of propaganda.
Propaganda was an integral part of the entire Nazi culture.
Ensuring that the Third Reich would survive in our darkest dreams.
So what was real? And what, if anything, has become of the Vril Society?
The problem with researching the Vril Society today is that clearly this concept attracts people of unsavory character.
Today there are many people still obsessed with Nazis, Hitler, and the most evil side of the occult. They intermingle legend, fantasy, and propaganda with the scarce facts. Some also believe in the possibility that intergalactic flight could be achieved through the Vril Society.
The Nazis were, at the very last 2 years of the war, working on secret project.
Their ultimate scheme was the Flying Disc Project, a concept based on Vril Society ideas.
We can clearly read in the 1930 pamphlets published by the Vril Society that, yes, there were blueprints. There's even a whole chapter explaining what an ideal spaceship might look to them if the right technology was being used.
Yeah, the real sources were actual blueprints.
I know that devices were built with the technology that the Vril Society was propagating well before the Second World War.
We don't know for sure whether Nazi scientists created flying saucers, but the Vril Society did envision them.
Am I skeptical of the whole Nazi UFO myth? Yes. On the other hand, there are certain tales that I still find hard to discount.
But the evidence has vanished.
The strange thing is that we know that these devices were built, but we can't find them anywhere anymore.
It has even been suggested that Vril technology was adapted for the US and Russian space programs.
I don't think so. I think they would be further ahead than anybody else on this planet.
So we're left to wonder what became of Vril technology, and what became of the Vril Society.
Well, the irony of history is that Nazi Germany, towards the end of the World War, pretty much evolved into becoming the Vril themselves.
In some ways, Hitler's Nazis did become a subterranean society. They built bunkers connecting one Nazi member to another, and countless tunnels containing weapons factories.
They did this, as is the official stance, because Allied bombers were bombing German cities and German factories into smithereens day after day, night after night.
One place where they built weapons was the tunnel complex in Nordhausen.
We know that they built their V-1s and V-2s there.
Hundreds of very real V-1 and V-2 rockets, built underground, soared through the skies to destroy their enemies. It has been said that the V stands for Vril. If true, Nazis and the Vrilja have become one.
My theory is that the search for this force changed themselves into, well, the carriers of the force.
More than 60 years after the fall of the Third Reich, where are the remnants of the Vril Society? Are they gone? Or are the ancient relics hiding away somewhere? Does a new regime exist among us, still plotting and scheming?
When you look at the tapestry of signals that I'm receiving, that I have received over the years, one can say that yes, there still is a Vril Society, but not comparable to what it was once before.
There still could be devotees of a fictional power amongst us today.
Vril in itself, if it had been there yesterday, it still is here today.
And Vril belief does still exist.
Every atom is basically 99% Vril energy.
Today in America, a small religious organization exists called the Church of Vrilology, where Bob, the Vril Master, calls on the Norse gods for Vril balance.
Hail Odin!
Though they seem a bit different than the norm, the Church of Vrilology is not the remnants of the evil Vril Society. They're simply a group of people trying to find their way to the light.
What we teach is to develop a relationship between the subconscious and the conscious so that we can, through the conscious mind, take the Vril energy and transform it into what we want in our lives.
The original occultist members of the Vril Society were at the other end of the spectrum, looking directly and deeply into the darkness to harvest and execute ultimate power.
New for Investigation Discovery here tomorrow night at 10. There are two brand new episodes of Crime Scene USA, Body of Evidence. Next tonight, though, a predatory rapist takes an accomplice in Couples Who Kill.